The word is ablaze in Cucaramana, a tiny Wayuu village in Colombia's Guajira province. It scorches the wind-burned desert afternoons during the midday gossip sessions of the village women who gather to pull water from the communal well. It burns on the tongues of the tribal leaders who guide their people from colorful hand-woven hammocks and flares up in the simple stories resembling fairy tales in the Wayunaiki language. The Arjuna, or outsider, is Claude Herviant, a Frenchman buried 20 years ago in the village burial ground, the only white man ever to have the privilege of being laid to rest in a Wayuu cemetery. The word spreads like wildfire among the native Cardona and Trupillo trees. The time to exhume the Arjuna has come and gone. Traditionally, his bones must be dug up by the hands of a woman who has fasted sexually as part of a ceremony that includes animal sacrifice and alcohol in abundance. The word has gone out to the Arjuna's family. If there is no exhumation, terrible things will continue to occur.
Habido desgracia. Bastante ha habido muerto. Muchas cosas han pasado en la familia mía.
Ya ha sido muy repetitivo las manifestaciones en los sueños y en las revelaciones y de personas autorizadas que ya ven y además que el tiempo que ha transcurrido es perentorio para que se aplique este segundo ritual del velorio de los restos del francés.
The petition reached France, but was met by such a different idea of death, one so pragmatic that no one in the Guajira can understand it.
Pour moi, quand on est mort. Moi, je suis pour la crémation. Qu'on brûle les corps, je suis pour ça. Qu'il soit en France ou en Colombie, ça me fait rien du tout. Pour moi, c'est pareil.
On April 2nd, 1937, the big house on Rue de la Independence in Perouge-sur-Marne was probably much the same as today. Claude Herviant was born there in his grandparents' big home for reasons that would perhaps seal his nomadic fate. In those days, it was quite common for women to give birth in the home of their parents. And only two short blocks away is the peaceful cemetery, Field of Death, and a constant in the life of Claude Herviant. The Guajira lies at the northern tip of the Southland, a head without a crown that marks the destiny of a solitary continent. And there, among the red sands and tempestuous seas, the people of the Guajira province. Both creative and fierce, primitive and contemporary, transient and stationary. A man arrived in this Republic of the Wind some 50 years after his birth. Claude Herviant was prepared to take it all in with his poet's eye and capture the unique world with his Eclair camera. This is how he saw it, how he described it.
Les Wayuu se sont peu à peu fixés dans des rancherias ou des villages. N'empêche qu'en eux demeure le goût de l'instable, le sens de la précarité.
The Montrouge Cemetery, the cemetery that remained with Hervion throughout his life, is an oasis of silence in the midst of a teeming metropolis. Two blocks away, at Avenue de la République, the building remains intact, as if Hervion weren't trapped in a tomb thousands of miles away, as if he were still a boy in the arms of Jean Gabriel, still the boy who played on the patio, and then, when older, bounded down the stairs noisily. The eldest son of a growing family, a precocious artist.
Il dessinait très bien, Claude. C'était un très bon dessinateur.
Nowadays, not far from Montrouge, you'll find an ethnically diverse and colorful Paris where the Algerian flag is often seen flapping wildly in the wind. But when Hervion was 20, Algeria's desire to become an independent nation was nothing more than a frustrated cry, muffled in the flag of a European power that controlled all things Algerian, except for that dream of freedom. Around the same time, Hervion reached the age when he would leave the house on Independence Street to complete his military service. An uncomfortable fate for a young man whose only creed was that of the trade union anarchist. For 4 years, Algeria's National Liberation Front had been fighting to gain their independence from France. On May 13, 1958, with France in political turmoil and on the brink of what seemed like civil war, blazing revolts exploded in both Algiers and Paris.
Que fait Claude Hervion? Il est dans une base militaire. Il réussit à convaincre ses camarades de défiler crosse en l'air, c'est-à-dire un acte de sédition. Il se retrouve en prison militaire, il va y rester 6 mois.
Algeria attained the freedom they so prized, and so did the rebellious Corporal Hervion. Here begins an untiring journey through life and an absolute refusal of any border. Hervion was the poet who prized love above understanding, the novelist who bent over backwards for the world but not for himself, the magazine editor, the radio broadcaster, the trout fisherman, the insatiable Parisian bohemian, the tour guide in Italy, the navigator who sailed a boat from India to France, the man thought to be crazy, who before he turned 45 fled to the hills of Gourdes and built a house of stone with his own hands.
Il avait construit sa maison lui-même et il vivait, non pas en autarcie, mais il vivait avec peu de moyens. Il avait toujours une voiture vieille, pourrie, qui tombait toujours en panne. Et je pense que c'était pas la quantité, l'argent n'était pas son moteur, clairement. Mais je pense qu'il manquait souvent d'argent. mais il avait assez joliment construit sa maison seul avec sa femme. Mais voilà, la maison n'avait pas coûté très cher.
The house would later be sold. Almost all of Hervion's books are now on the other side of France, in Lille, in the home of his eldest son, Manuel. Only lately, as she approaches adolescence, has Flora, Manuel's daughter and Claude's only grandchild, begun to learn the details of the incredible life of her grandfather, who, after being born into a sedentary civilization, allowed the nomadic rebel inside to flourish.
Je pense par son amour des nomades, simplement. Par son respect, par son intérêt pour les peuples nomades. Je pense que c'est ça qui fait qu'il était plus ou moins dans la tête nomade, quoi.
In this Wahira of furtive moons, he dies twice. The first death is partial and happens on land. The second is definitive and takes place in the Japira, the Wayu heaven, whose gates stand on the northernmost tip of land known as the Cabo de la Vela. The second funeral is one of the most unique ceremonies celebrated by this ritualistic society. The moment when the deceased's bones come once again in contact with the air and the solemn stares of family and friends. The Wahira people believe that the unearthing of the bones, a solemn event that takes place at dawn and includes libations and a banquet, is a strict order from Mariwa, which if disobeyed causes drought, desolation, nightmares, and death. Mourning at both the first funeral and the second, some 10 years later, is equally as profound. Ceremonies such as this one, grounded in a civilization's uniquely mysterious relationship with death and posterity, are what attracted Claude Herviant to ancient peoples and to filmmaking as well. A nomadic voice spoke from inside him. All he did was listen.
Le cinéma l'intéressait sans aucun doute, mais il était poète essentiellement. Il gagnait sa vie comme il pouvait, pas si bien que ça, et il est venu me trouver pour me dire « J'aimerais bien faire une série de films sur les nomades à travers le monde. »
And so, Chronique Nomade was born. The search for an endangered species. The tribes that, like Herviant's soul, were forever on the move. First, it was the Tuaregs in Nigeria. Then the Bororos in the Sahara, a chapter directed by the great Werner Herzog. Around the time of Chronique Nomade, Claude Herviant met Jacqueline André, who would become his companion during the difficult production period of a series full of obstacles and often real torment.
Et très sensible, très fragile. Moi, je lui disais toujours, tu es pessimiste. Et il me répondait, non, je suis un optimiste désespéré.
Desperately optimistic, he produced the third chapter, this time with his friend Jacques Doyon, on the Lohars from Rajasthan, India. Herviant made his presence felt from the moment members of the French crew argued they couldn't drink the same water as their hosts.
Alors, la question, c'est de se dire, mais si on boit tout ça pendant 15 jours, on va attraper des amibes, on va rentrer extrêmement malade. Et puis on s'est regardé avec Claude et on s'est dit, ouais, si on fait ce film, si on nous offre quelque chose, pas question de le refuser. Il y a des gens pauvres qui nous offrent un verre d'eau, on boit le verre d'eau. Ou alors on reste chez nous, à Paris, ou on s'enferme dans l'ambassade américaine et on ne bouge plus de chez nous, voilà.
But there were worse confrontations to come. In keeping with the current tendency among nomadic tribes, the Lohars had become sedentary, converting their carts into stationary homes. To film the story of Mangwe, the girl who starred in the film, wheels had to be reinstalled on the carts and oxen had to be rented. In 1986, Herviant made his first trip to the Wahira province and was welcomed with living tradition, historic obstinacy, and the cultural arguments that immediately hinted at a great documentary, although the people he met there were no longer very nomadic either.
Encontraba una variante de una sociedad con una gran propensión pastoril, con una historia muy compleja, con una cultura muy rica, muchas variantes, que hacía que la serie que él producía sobre pueblos pastoralistas fuese mucho más interesante.
One Wayuu village was especially convenient for filming. Kukurumana, located only 10 minutes from the capital city of Riohacha, slightly removed from the desert, but seemingly remote. And so submerged in the proverbial Guajira, conversing with the anthropologist, the tribal leader, and many new friends, Herviant conceived the story of a Wayuu matriarch left without any family after a clan war, and who, in the midst of a terrible drought, begins a journey with her two grandchildren to Japira. Herviant returned to Paris and his old Bohemian haunts and found the perfect ally, Francisco Norden, a Colombian filmmaker fresh from his first successful feature film, Condores No Entrian Todos Los Días. Little has changed at Le Select Café in Montparnasse since the days when Herviant and Norden sat down to develop their project.
Me expuso el proyecto, yo me entusiasmé mucho y le dije que naturalmente estaba dispuesto a seguirla, a proseguir con él la investigación y a ponerme a su entera disposición para el rodaje en La Guajira cuando la producción estuviera lista.
Meanwhile, in the southern Philippines, Herviant filmed the fourth chapter in his series, The Banhaus, Aquatic Nomads of the China Sea, a shoot that turned into a dangerous adventure.
Donc pour les voir, il fallait qu'on parte en bateau et qu'on allait les chercher et ils n'étaient jamais au même endroit. Et donc quand on partait, les gens du village, le chef du village, ils mettaient AM16 dans le bateau. Moi, il fallait que je me cache pour pas qu'on voit que j'étais blanche. Et là, j'ai été... Quand on partait en bateau, on ne savait jamais si on allait revenir.
Everything had been planned, location by location, for the Guajira shoot, when a serious problem arose. The official French channel, Antenne 2, withdrew their support due to a lack of audience interest. It was only natural. This wasn't the normal ethno show quickly becoming part of the international television programming, but instead, pure visual poetry.
Alors là, c'était la catastrophe pour Claude chaque fois, quoi. Alors, pff, tomber en bas. Et on tenait bon, et moi j'ai recherché un autre producteur et tout, et j'ai trouvé Patrick Sandrin, qui a dit oui tout de suite, et qui s'est vraiment, je dirais, se mouiller, quoi, qui a pris des risques.
Claude Herviant's diary includes a detailed account of his arrival in Colombia on Sunday, February 5th, 1989. Along with a precise shooting schedule, details of the uninterrupted pain he was experiencing in his back, and how much he missed Jacqueline. In the Guajira capital of Riohacha, where time moved very slowly, the Frenchman found pre-production days exasperating. He was determined to film a second funeral in Cucaramana, but death remained elusive. A local patriarch had opened the doors to his home, the only white house in town. Leader Jose Maria Castro is still there, as if nodding at posterity, with his wife Bonifacia ever at his side. She's blind now. Jose Maria, although no longer able to remember his age, has hung on to his atavistic authority and never forgotten the Frenchman, who instantly became his friend and who made him, his wife, and their daughter the stars of his film. Today, Maria Angelica van Grieken, the girl inside her mother's womb at the time, is 20 years old. She hasn't been able to carry on her studies and is convinced that if the European had lived to be her godfather, her fate would have been different, and her life in the limelight would not have been reduced to the fleeting role of daughter of the laughing weaver. Oh, Pre-production in Riohacha during the 1980s was especially difficult for Claude Herriant, who really didn't have much money to spend or time to lose. And obstacles continued to appear, one in particular. In the remote village of Kereme, in the middle of the desert, he had located the perfect actress for his leading lady. Her name was Yuraminia Ipuana, but she preferred her nickname Cantus, the sound of which would even work for the title of the film. But a week before the cameras were scheduled to start shooting, she refused. She was a stubborn, sedentary woman, and although she sympathized with the strange nomadic foreigner, she was convinced the French device would steal her soul. On the fourth day of his visit to Colombia, while looking out on the impetuous Caribbean from the Guajira coastline, Herriant had the mystic experience that would change his life. He narrated it himself with the pulse of a poet in a letter to Jacqueline.
Je pense toujours qu'il n'est jamais trop tard pour rattraper les erreurs si le cœur y est, en dépit de tout.
J'ai été mis en présence d'un sorcier Wayu, qui a bien voulu interroger les esprits, car il me trouvait un regard qui lui posait des questions.
J'ai senti très précisément les battements de mon cœur ralentir, et il a dit « Je retire en toi le venin qui t'empêchait d'aimer ». J'avais fermé les yeux, et sentais toujours sa main enserrer mon poignet. Lorsque je les ai ouverts, je me suis aperçu qu'il était à 3 mètres de moi. C'est ainsi, je crois. Je t'embrasse, Claude.
On Saturday, the 11th, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, with no leading lady, shooting begins on Kereme. It wasn't until the next day, the second day of shooting, that it all came together.
Nous arrivons à convaincre Cantus, très beau paysage, sur le camino avec les ânes, les enfants et les chevaux. Le vent souffle toujours autant. Tout est très compliqué. Les discussions n'en finissent pas entre Iris, Martha, à propos de Cantus, qui n'est pas facile à décider, de quitter sa rancheria qu'elle n'a pas quittée depuis sa naissance.
Herviant managed to convince the indomitable sedentary woman to travel to Cabo de la Vela.
Lundi 13. Je viens de me tremper. L'eau est plus fraîche qu'aux Philippines, et surtout, le vent souffle plus fort. Je pense à Jacqueline, qui aurait pu être là bientôt. L'organisation est délicate à cause de Cantus qui complique en ayant avec Iris de bonnes raisons pour toujours retourner chez elle. Il fait chaud.
That Monday, the 13th, they successfully filmed the scenes in which Cantus reaches Japira after journeying across the Guajira Desert. After 3 days of shooting, and in spite of complications with the actress, Claude had at least filmed the plotline. Uribia, the desert capital, a mirage of daytime moons, where gasoline is pumped by human lungs, and a ghost train can suddenly appear. There, inside an unfinished house, Cantu's lineage is alive and kicking. Brigida Ipuana sits down every day at her loom, armed with incredible calm, to weave life. This very same Brigida, now a mother herself, played the role of Cantu's granddaughter, her own grandmother in real life. And only a few feet away, in a chorus of hands, another grandchild, Maria Teresa Fernandez, deftly weaves multicolored mochila bags. Maria Teresa was an adolescent at the time the film was shot. She was taking care of her grandmother that Monday the 13th when the leading lady suddenly broke down off camera in a flood of tears.
Entonces yo le dije, abuelo, ¿y por qué lloraste cuando miraste a tu prima? Le dije, no sé, será de la emoción, no sé, presiento algo, me desperté hasta ahí, presiento algo malo que va a pasar.
Mardi 14. Retour Cabo de la Vela. Cucuramana, crevaison. Sur la route goudronnée, mais pas de route secours. Et l'autre voiture était devant, trop loin. On attend.
Entonces el señor lo cambió. Yo sí vi que él puso tres disparos nada más. Entonces yo le dije, ¿será que llegamos con los tres arriba? Llegamos bien, le dije. Sí, tranquilo, aquí no va a pasar nada.
The Virgin still stands, poised with the same circumspect and healing gesture she displayed on that Tuesday, February the 14th. Her holy aura shielding the same spot where Cantu's foreboding prophecy came true. The sun was preparing to set. Herviant wanted to reach Cucuramana before sundown.
Y al llegar aquí al sitio de Aremasay, el carro me botó la llanta. Dio cuatro vueltas y quedó otra vez con el frente hacia arriba. Y él quedó como a 5 metros delante de la camioneta, tirado. Ahí los compañeros se acercaron, auxiliaron, pero no lo pudieron auxiliar porque yo en el momento pedían era una ambulancia. Y como en ese tiempo aquí las ambulancias eran muy escasas, el señor demoró más de 2 horas ahí, tirado.
Finally, in front of the eyes of the unmoving Virgin, and with the sun's final breath, Herviant was taken to Our Lady of Remedios Hospital in Riohacha, just as Francisco Norden remembers it, after watching it all come to pass from one of the other vehicles.
Pudimos llegar a Riohacha. Claude estaba vivo, y él murió en manos de unos médicos carniceros que había en el hospital de Riohacha.
Claude Herviant died as he wanted, in a remote but not foreign city. After all, no city is foreign to a nomad. The embassy intervened, and preparations were made to fly the body home to France.
Punaise, quand j'ai entendu le mot rapatrier, c'est à ce moment. La veille, j'ai pas parlé de faut le laisser avec les nomades. J'étais sur le coup de l'annonce. J'ai pas du tout pensé à ça. C'est le lendemain au téléphone, quand elle me dit « Bogota a téléphoné, ils vont rapatrier Claude oh ». Alors là, le mot « rapatrier » dans ma tête, ça fait titre. Tout de suite, je dis « Ah non, faut pas du tout, faut qu'il soit enterré comme nomade ». Et là, j'ai dit à ce moment-là tout ce que je vous ai déjà dit.
Jacqueline André reacted in time from Paris, remaining lucid enough in her grief to stop the repatriation. Remembering something Claude had made her swear a few years earlier.
C'est difficile parce que il me disait toujours s'il m'arrive quelque chose dans la vie, je ne veux pas aller dans les hôpitaux, rester avec nous, il disait je veux aller mourir près d'eux tout le temps.
Together with Nicole, Claude's first wife and his two eldest children immediately booked a flight. But there was still one major problem to solve in Cucuramana. They wanted to respect Claude's will and bury him among the natives, but this was not going to be easy. The ancient unwritten Wayuu codes did not allow, still do not allow, a white man to be buried in one of their cemeteries. tribal leaders and spokesmen gathered together in Cucuramana under the leadership of Socrates Uriana, now 82 years old, and fated for a bitter drink of French ethnodrama. Once given permission, the production crew kept the cameras rolling. And so the film, Cantu's El Viaje Final, begins with Hervian's funeral and includes shots of his family flown in from France. Claude was buried at a certain distance from the other tombs, like a prudent stranger surrounded by pui trees, bathed in sunsets and mystery, attended to every November 2nd, Day of the Dead, by Hilda Bonivento, another of the film's actors.
Esas son cosas que le da uno sentimiento. Entonces uno visita la tumba, ahí va a ser conforma uno. Ya uno va tranquila ya, de que ya cumplimos, de que como si lo hubieran visto personal como éramos antes.
Time passed, and Cantu Sipuana joined Claude on the final journey, and years later, with rigorous punctuality, received her second funeral ceremonial. The earth continued to turn, and on it, as if traveling on a ball with no set destination, La Guajira and France, France and La Guajira, each with its own rhythm. Eighteen years after his funeral, a white woman upset the peace in Cucuramana. She was a Spanish philologist and had come to visit the grave.
Cuando hubo un momento que ella nos dijo que ella se quería quedar sola en la tumba un ratico. Pues nosotros estábamos preparados para que ella se demorara todo lo que ella quisiera, pero no se demoró mucho. Yo creo que ella estuvo allí 6-7 minutos. Nosotros estábamos afuera del cementerio, en la enramada que tenía, que tiene el cementerio fuera. Ella vino y nos dijo que ella consideraba que ya ella había hecho lo que había venido a hacer.
She had crossed the ocean to leave flowers and pronounce a few poetic words.
Ella vino a decirle en la tumba algo que se le quedó pendiente de decirle en vida.
El Tiempo newspaper published the amazing story. The transatlantic visitor had received the Wayuu's words and agreed to carry them back to Europe, look for Claude's family, and tell them how urgent it was that his second funeral be held. Soon, word reached Manuel Herviant, who received a call from the philologist in 2007.
Les Wayuu lui auraient demandé de, en France, nous contacter quoi, pour le second enterrement. Mais moi, cette femme, je la connaissais pas, même si elle me disait qu'elle nous avait connus tout petit. Et quand je l'ai eu au téléphone ou par mail. Elle m'a dit oui, bah, il faut, si tu peux faire ça, il faut le faire, c'est important pour eux, tout ça. Mais j'avoue que moi, je n'avais pas les moyens d'aller en Colombie, quoi, trop, très cher. Donc, je n'ai pas beaucoup d'argent et en fait, je ne pouvais pas monter un projet comme ça sans savoir la réalité, quoi.
Shortly afterwards, Manuel Herviant received perhaps the strangest message any Frenchman has ever received.
Muchos de los ancianos y mujeres dicen haber visto en sueños a su padre pidiéndoles que cumplan con el ritual.
The Wayuu anthropologist Wilder Guerra sent word from Riohacha insisting on the second funeral.
Luego perdimos la comunicación y digamos que el tema se durmió durante un largo tiempo.
During this time, the Museum of Mankind in Paris remembered Herviant and scheduled a retrospective of his Chroniques Nomades. But soon afterward, the poet was again left on his pedestal of indifference. In the Guajira, the word continued to blaze, and strange things continued to occur across the land. Finally, in 2009, the word is revitalized and insists, traveling to Europe in a tiny electronic box containing a question: who is willing to listen to this Aboriginal cry? First stop, Barcelona. And a very bad beginning. The transatlantic lady wants nothing to do with it. Next, the south of France, Tout Pertuis, and the marvelous southern home of Jean-Michel, the youngest of the Herviant siblings. Judging from his reaction, there's little chance Jean-Michel will be attending the funeral.
Il est enterré sur une tombe où il y a une croix de Jésus et qu'il n'était pas croyant. Et ça, je trouve que c'est pas très bien.
Word flies on to Paris and Cherche Midi, a publishing company run by Pierre Draclin.
C'est très émouvant.
Next stop, Brussels, and another country in a hurry, Belgium. There, in a temporary rental in a towering downtown apartment building, director Jacques Doyon hears the news of his old traveling companion. The renowned filmmaker insists that if his agenda allows, he will attend the second funeral. From his house in Lille, Manuel looks back after 20 years and hears the voices of the Wayuu. Finally, in the Paris that was once home to her romance with the nomadic and spirited Herviant, Jacqueline André faces memories that had been sleeping for 20 years.
Oui, je reconnais elle. J'ai l'impression maintenant que ça remonte à la surface et c'est comme si c'était hier, quoi. Je me retrouve plongée dans cette vie des nomades.
Word has reached France, and although no one has yet confirmed their attendance, the Guajiras are now ready to stand up for their laws. They fix the date. Since it couldn't take place too long after January, the month of the burials, the 6th of March was the chosen date. 5 weeks before the date arrives, Jacqueline André sends word. She won't be traveling to Colombia. With words already spoken and the dice already cast, the weekend dawns sunny and tinged with a palpable mixture of pain and relief. Activity in the tiny cemetery is non-stop, while guests begin to arrive from all over the desert. In an airport not far from there, the somewhat tense vigil for the Frenchman continues. Meanwhile, La Pocha Gonzalez has arrived from Juarez, Venezuela, on the eastern edge of the Republic of the Wind with her daughter, Masula. The matron has just dug up the remains of her two sons and has offered, with genuine Guajira courtesy, to head up the exhumation of Claude Herviant, a service for which a woman must undergo a prolonged period of sexual abstinence.
No puede tener relaciones, por eso siempre se elige las abuelas. Una joven que no tenga marido, porque, y también lo pueden hacer quien tenga su marido, pero haciendo un compromiso ante su familia y la comunidad wayú de que no va a tener relaciones, mínimo 3 meses.
At the airport, the suspense finally comes to a close. Against all French skepticism, Manuel and Jacqueline have kept their word and complied with Claude's wishes. Back in Cucaramana, the first thing to do is visit Elder Jose Maria.
Mm-hmm.
Lo guay, para nosotros los guayú es muy importante la amistad. Para que le hagan daño a un amigo en nuestra casa, tienen que pasar por nuestro cadáver. Primero, para nosotros es muy importante la amistad. Un amigo es un hermano.
Un amigo es como...
Then on to a visit that is both greeting and farewell. The ceremony has been scheduled for the following dawn. That night, the magic of film, the same magic that captivated Claude Herviant, shines in the desert with the long-awaited premiere of Cantus in Cucaramana.
En lisière de la mer Caraïbe, à l'extrême nord de la Colombie, est une péninsule semi-désertique. À l'échelle de la Colombie et du Venezuela, qui en possède le quart, elle apparaît comme un lopin de sable, de sel et de soleil.
Hilda Bonavento finally sees herself in the role of the woman in the white robe who welcomes Cantus. Luis Alfonso, when he was only a boy. Monica, the teacher, the same age as the students she now teaches. There they are, up on the screen. The day-to-day lives borrowed by the man in the nearby tomb to create his visual poem.
La vie, de la naissance à la mort, pourrait être décrite comme le passage d'un hamac dans l'autre.
Soon, the Arahuna will be gone. Everything is ready for the following morning at first light.
A fumar todos los hombres.
At the last minute, surprise guests arrive from Carame, the women of the Ipuana clan. the descendants of Cantus.
Brígida. Ah, Brígida era parte de la película.
Dès que j'ai mis les pieds, je suis arrivée en Colombie, j'ai plus eu peur. Et encore moins à l'enterrement, j'ai pas eu peur que de le voir, quand les os, pour moi, c'était quelque chose de beau, je vivais quelque chose de beau et de magique.
And so, Claude Herviant leaves the place that was his home, the place that sheltered him from the rain and sun. Even in death, the nomad continues to move on. This time on his final journey, a crematorium and then on to Japira, the Wayuu heaven he visited the day of his first death, ready now to welcome him into paradise. Claude Herviant travels now as ash on the wind and the sea. His legacy on the page, in images, remains behind on dry land, and endless memories. the man who moved horse-drawn carts in Rajasthan and tried to mobilize sedentary peoples around the world, will remain in motion forever, as if the only great nomad in his own personal story were the man himself. He is now officially what he longed to be, a man without a country or borders. His home as open as the air and his heart as wild as the sea. A man who loved, fought, felt, and was rendered a poem composed from ashes. A man who spent 20 years inside his vault listening to the word and emerged a reconfirmed and eternal nomad.